Each and every one of us has two ears coated in wax. That's weird. But have you ever stopped and wondered what earwax actually is? And more importantly, why do we have it?
Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
The stuff we call earwax has a more scientific name, cerumen. It's made by glands deep in the ear canal and slowly oozes its way towards the opening of the ear. As icky as it might seem, earwax is actually good for you. The sticky cerumen acts like a protective barrier for the super sensitive skin inside your ear. The earwax does a lot to protect the delicate parts of your inner ear. It traps dirt and germs, it keeps water out, and it collects bacteria and other dusty allergens and irritants. Usually, earwax naturally disappears over time, eventually moving from deep in the ear all the way out to the opening where it falls, flakes, or washes away. Then, fresh new earwax is created and the cycle starts again. Sometimes, earwax can build up over time if your glands are producing too much of the stuff. When that happens, the extra wax can dry up and harden, causing a blockage that can hurt or make it hard to hear. Even though they seem like the perfect tool for the job, you really shouldn't use cotton swabs to try and get rid of excess earwax. Usually, it just pushes the extra wax deeper and packs it down, making the problem worse. The inside of the ear is very sensitive, so if you're walking around with way too much earwax, you're better off going to the doctor rather than trying to scoop it out yourself. So, why do we have earwax? To help keep our ears healthy, even if sometimes it can get a little bit gross. Nothing's quite so gross as a big, fat pimple that's just about ready to pop. But have you ever stopped and wondered, why do we get pimples?
Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
It doesn't matter how many times you wash your face, you're almost certainly going to get some zits at some point in your life. As you turn into young teens, your body's going to overdrive, producing all kinds of new chemicals and hormones to help you grow. One of the ways your body goes into overdrive is by producing extra oil in the oil glands on your face. It might sound funny, but having oil on your skin is actually super important to keeping it healthy. But as your body grows, sometimes it produces more oil than it needs, which combines with dead skin and bacteria to clog your skin pores. We call those clogged pores pimples, zits, acne, blemishes, blackheads, whiteheads, and all sorts of other names. So if you wake up on the morning of school picture day with a big fat blemish right on the tip of your nose, don't freak out. The best thing you can do is wash regularly and avoid touching your face because this can spread the oil around and cause other breakouts. Oh, and one more thing that's a lot easier said than done, don't pop your pimples. I know, it's almost impossible to resist, but according to skin doctors, you're better off letting pimples run their course naturally. Popping them can actually push the bacteria deeper into the skin, causing even more redness and irritation. And now you know why we all get pimples. Nothing makes a scorching hot day worse than getting all sweaty. So why does it happen? Do we really need to sweat?
Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
It sure stinks to get all sweaty, sometimes literally. But it turns out that sweating is actually a key part of helping regulate your body temperature. Everybody has 2 million sweat glands in their body. The only place with none are the lips. It might not seem like it, but your body is pretty much always sweating. You just don't notice it because it evaporates from your skin before enough builds up to make a bead of sweat. When your body starts to get too warm, your brain sends signals to those 2 million sweat glands, telling them to release sweat from your pores. When that sweat evaporates on your skin, it takes some of the heat with it and helps cool you down. But when your body is extra hot, like after exercise or on a humid summer day, that sweat builds up faster than it can evaporate. Most of us don't really like to sweat. It's wet, sticky, stinky, and uncomfortable. But despite all that, you should be happy you sweat. Without sweat to help cool you down, your body would overheat, which can make you really sick or even kill you. Okay, so that's why we sweat, to help us stay cool. But why is our sweat salty? Well, sweat is mostly made up of good old-fashioned water, but there's also trace amounts of other things in there too. Chemicals, sugars, and salts. These all make their way into your body and eventually work their way into your sweat glands. Your body filters out most of that salt from your sweat, but enough gets through to give sweat that trademark salty taste. Now I want French fries. Is that weird? And now you know why you sweat. Everyone knows there's nothing funnier than a fart. But have you ever stopped and wondered why we get gas in the first place? Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
Unfortunately for us all, everything we eat and drink makes us fart. We pass gas about 20 times per day, and sometimes more. You see, every time we swallow food or slurp down a drink, we swallow a little bit of air with it. All that gas builds up inside our bodies and, well, has to come out one way or another. The air can come back out in the form of a burp or, much more hilariously, as a fart. Okay, so pretty simple. We pass gas from our mouths or butts when we've swallowed too much air, but why do some stink and some don't? That has more to do with the bacteria in our guts. You see, the bacteria in your intestines help break down the food you eat. That process releases special gases that stink pretty bad. There are four basic types of sugar in food that cause a stinky reaction. The first is fructose, which is found in some tree fruits, berries, corn, sugarcane, and beets. The second is lactose, which is the sugars in milk and other dairy products that make them sweet. Third is raffinose, which is in beans, broccoli, asparagus, cabbage, and other vegetables. Last is sorbitol, which is found naturally in fruits and made artificially in corn syrup. Okay, so that's why some farts stink, but how about the noise? Why are some silent while others are quite loud? How loud a fart is depends on how much gas is built up, how fast it comes out, and how tightly you're clenching your, well, you know. If your muscles are more relaxed, you'll likely pass some quiet gas. But when you're trying not to fart and clenching up, the intense release causes all kinds of vibrations that can make it extra loud. And now you know why we fart. Everybody's been there. Whether you ate something awful, rode one too many roller coasters, or just got a little too anxious, it's always the same. You start to feel nauseous, and then suddenly you throw up. But why? What actually causes us to puke? And what purpose does it serve? Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
Right before you throw up, lots of things happen inside your body to prepare. Your mouth coats your teeth in saliva to protect them from the stomach acids in your puke. Usually, blood drains from your face as your body redirects it to your vital organs. And just as you're about to throw up, the muscles in your abs and diaphragm literally squeeze your stomach, forcing its icky contents back up your digestive tract to your throat and then your mouth. One of the main reasons we puke is to keep from being poisoned. Most animals eat small meals wherever they can find them. So if they do eat something poisonous, their body can usually fight it off before it kills them. But since humans eat such large portions in a single sitting, we're more likely to be poisoned. So, when it comes to ingesting anything toxic, being able to puke can actually save your life. But it doesn't always have to be poison. If your stomach senses it's too full, or if you catch some sort of stomach bug like a flu, that can trigger vomiting too. Another common cause is motion sickness. Experts can't say for sure why this causes us to get nauseous and even puke, but they do have a leading theory. When our balance is thrown off, say after spinning around a bunch or riding on a wavy boat, our senses get confused and send the brain all kinds of mixed messages about what's going on, sending our body into emergency mode. And finally, puking isn't always caused by something physical.
Our emotions can make us throw up too. We can vomit if we're overly scared, sad, or grossed out by something. Or someone. So, why do we throw up? It turns out, for lots of different reasons. Just maybe take some precautions and decide on cotton candy after you ride the roller coaster. And now you know why we all throw up. Have you ever been halfway through a sneezing fit and wondered to yourself, why do we sneeze in the first place? Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
Basically, a sneeze is just your body's natural way of trying to eject something from inside your nose that's not supposed to be there. There's lots of common things that get into our nose and cause irritation, like pepper, perfume, smoke, dust particles, and allergies. When the sensitive skin on the inside of your nose detects an unwanted substance, it sends an electric signal to your brain. This signal tells your brain that your nose needs to be cleared. Now it's time for a sneeze, so your brain has to get your whole body on board. In the second or two your brain has to prep before a sneeze, your eyes are forced shut and your tongue pushes up against the roof of your mouth and your muscles brace themselves for the ejection. And for good reason. When you sneeze, you're shooting air, water, and mucus from your nose at over 100 miles per hour. That's some incredible force. So a big part of the reason you sneeze is to get rid of bad particles in your nose, but that isn't the only reason. In 2012, researchers discovered that sneezing is your nose's way of resetting itself. The cells that line the walls of your nostrils are rebooted, like restarting a computer. And while sneezing might be healthy for you, it does release a ton of bacteria and microbes into the air that can spread sickness. So sneeze with caution. Oh, and there's also a special kind of sneezer out there worthy of a mention. They're called photic sneezers, and you might be one of them. These are people who sneeze when they look at a bright light or up at the sun. Being a photic sneezer is something you inherit from your parents, but experts aren't sure what about bright light caused some people to sneeze. They do think it affects between 20 and 35% of the population. Some expert who loves a good dad joke gave the photic sneeze a clever scientific name: autosomal dominant compelling helio-ophthalmic outburst syndrome, or achoo syndrome. And now you know why you sneeze.